Hello, and welcome back to the Plutocracy Report on PRN. I'm Vince Marcanti, coming to you from the Great White North, where Chicago is now Canada, and the jet stream is broken, impeded, and upsetting. The news of cold air sinking down on us from Canada has been unrelenting the last 2 weeks. But they don't mention how alarming this broken, meandering, oscillating, and unusual jet stream pattern is, and how it gets locked this way for long durations. I mean, the ridiculously resilient ridge is a term they created, you know, to make it seem normal, which is an atmospheric blocking phenomenon, apparently named for its tenacity and unrelenting presence within the atmosphere off of California's coast. A ridge is an area within the atmosphere in which there is unusually high pressure. That pressure was ridiculously high from around 2011 to 2017, high enough to last for several years and cause the horrific drought conditions that Californians know all too well. I say it's back periodically, and I suspect weather manipulation via ionosphere heaters or harp down blasts to help create this persistent high pressure zone and bring the results they want. You know, cold air being brought down from Canada to heavily populated areas of the USA. Yes, the plutocrats don't care that California suffers, you know, by not getting rain, as the ridge pushes the Pacific storm track way north by forcing moist atmospheric river storms over the open ocean, veering directly northward. It looks like the subtropical jet stream hits a wall there. I mean, check out the models yourself. I've posted some on Facebook, so if you want to friend me there, sometimes I post some good stuff. But, you know, look at the models yourself. It's unbelievable. And let me know if you think geoengineering for weather modification is apparent. We know they have the technology. And like I said, they don't care about California being dried out because the news of cold, cold, cold is great for making global warming not seem so dire. Also, chemical ice nucleation for weather modification is definitely being utilized. And of course, solar radiation management is being used. And I don't like where this is going. Let's end it all. Let the Earth react naturally to the changes we are causing while we try to nurture what's left of our habitat for humans and change our destructive ways and adapt to what we can expect. That would be rational, but we don't do things that way, do we? I mean, just by ending geoengineering is not going to make everything great. There's going to be a lot of changes and a lot of trouble in the future, and the UV will be intense, and the ozone layer is disintegrating, but there would be more rain when we end geoengineering, which disrupts the hydrological cycle. But the Earth needs holistic healing, not a goddarn pharmaceutical approach like we use to human health for profits. It's time to take back our government and stop all secret programs. All right, well, that's it for the environment news for now. Go to Geoengineering Watch for more research. You know, Wigington knows more than I do on that issue. I'm just a plutocracy expert and an expert of sexiness. La la. Well, you know what? When you do research, use DuckDuckGo search engine instead of Google, or you won't find any unbiased research. I mean, Google is out of control and must be abandoned. All right, I'm sorry I sound all stuffy today and weird, because I am. I mean, it's been so dry in this house ever since the polar plunge hit from this damn jet stream pattern we have. But I'm going to fight through it. And in the second half of the show, I want to talk about the military coup in Bolivia. And we will feature the return of the award-winning show. What the hell going on out there? So, stick around, even though I sound like I have a cold. And my sinuses are going crazy. But now, my opening rant. The theme of this segment is super rich pricks. Because they rule the world and are the reason for all governmental tragedy and oppression. Their mental control over the sheepies in order to get the masses to accept their gluttonous control of both government and industry is stupefying. Our country has always been a plutocracy, and we let it grow and gain total power without much resistance. And now there is a transnational class of globalized plutocrat power elites. They are not the puppets in government, but they control, manage, and hoard over half of global capital. Yes, the top 1% has more than half of the world's wealth, okay? In fact, only 6 sick sociopaths do. And in order to achieve this appalling rate of inequality, they have to control government policy and mainstream media, both of which they have purchased long ago. This makes our country a plutocracy, and the super rich are the plutocrats. The power elite operate as a non-governmental network, but they clearly control government and markets and have one common greedy interest. Keep things the same. Maintain inequality. They do anything to maintain this unjust socioeconomic system. That should have crashed by now. But they control the monetary system and are allowed to create new money at will and add unlimited new debt and keep interest rates around zero to artificially avoid a crash. For now. 10 years now, they've been holding up the plutonomy house of cards. You know, the low interest and quantitative easing way. We allowed for this massive inequality and have been brainwashed by their omnipresent propaganda through media monopoly. Now, below these disgusting plutocrats are the elected leaders, you know, the political puppets, who have the same common interests of the power elite. And some of them are billionaires already, and most are filthy rich. All of them are in the top 30%, even the top of the top 30%. And they control, listen to this, the top 30% control 95% of the world's wealth, while the remaining 70% sheepies fight over less than 5% of the remaining scraps. Think about that, my friends. That means they have perfected propaganda for sustaining mass inequality, and there's been no sheepy revolt yet, not here anyways. Despite this level of domination, they know that when prices go up, the sheepies may wake up. And of course, contingency plans are obviously arranged. This is our last chance to take back our government before it's too late. There's a battle going on around the world against inequality, but the American people have yet to get involved, and we are the crucial factor. There are so many losses still going on, you know, like the crazy fascist military coup in Bolivia and Assange and Manning in jail. The power structure will do anything to get its way, like assassinating people who threaten them or throw them in jail or staging terror and false flag events on a huge scale and controlling the industrial congressional military complex. And they made all public interest private profit interests. Nothing can improve till we end their reign of terror in whole and immediately. Not incrementally with a 3% tax increase on them, but entirely. Let's look at what the current propaganda out there is and see how it's always the same. Here is a quote from the super hard-working billionaire hedge fund manager, Leon Cooperman.
I don't need Elizabeth Warren telling me that I'm a deadbeat and that billionaires are deadbeat. The vilification of billionaires makes no sense to me. The world is a substantially better place because of Bill Gates, Michael Bloomberg, David Rubenstein, Bernie Marcus, and Ken Lagrone.
Oh my God. Excuse me while I gag. Substantially better for whom, Leon? Well, certainly for billionaires, but not humanity. Oh, right, I get it. You guys are better and more important than the lower 90%, so I guess your set of living arrangements are all that matters. He added this.
This is idiocy. It's appealing to the lowest common denominator and basically trying to turn people's heads around by promising a lot of free stuff.
Said the rat who has more money than you could possibly need in 1,000 lifetimes. Now, just think about it. What is $1 billion? Look at that for a moment, my friends. 1,000 million is a billion.
Just think about that.
We used to think a million seemed like a lot of money, right? 1 million seconds is about 11 days. 1 billion seconds is 31 and a half freaking years. I mean, I didn't do the math there. I read it somewhere. I ain't no math guy. But think about that. It's just a numbers game to them. Could anyone ever need that much freaking money? I mean, if you gave it to me, I actually could use it to do good things. But no good people have ever amassed that amount of money and were able to live with themselves by hoarding it. I mean, it could be used to help society, but they would rather increase the digits and rank higher on the sociopathic scale. I figure, you know, if you hoard more than, say, I don't know, what, 50 million, 100 million? Well, you're insane and grossly greedy. You have a problem and a socially detrimental addiction to class status and egotism and severe mental illness. Bezos, the bozo, is said to have $110 billion. Yeah, well, I heard he had $170 billion last year, so I don't think we really know for sure how much that scumbag really has. But our government created and facilitates this beyond insane level of greed. And what is government for if not to assure equality and that this kind of sociopathic capital hoarding isn't allowed? Filthy rich pricks should be institutionalized, and instead they rule the world. Billionaires run for political office, and they win, like Trump and that Fred Flintstone-looking buffoon, J.B. Pritzker, the governor of Illinois. Hell, maybe Bloomberg will be the next president, you know, because he's so qualified for being a greedy prick and a D-bag. Man, do I not like that guy. Well, how could I like any billionaire? Why would we show any respect to insane people like this? Well, I'll tell you, because of our sick culture that values money hoarding more than compassion and equality. And because of ubiquitous capitalist propaganda. Now, let's look a little further into this article by CNBC. Because this is propaganda that's out there. And it's the same tactics that they've been using for a long time. And this was the headline that got my attention. Paul Tudor Jones sees the S&P 500 plunging 25% if Warren is elected. And jumping another 15% on Trump. Oh, boy, we better re-elect Chumpa Wumpa, huh? So two things that I predict over a year ago is verified here. First, they ignore Bernie and are making Liz Warren seem like a radical socialist that might actually have a chance to win. She will be the hope and change candidate like Obama was. That Democrats need to be inspired enough to get out and vote harder. I mean, bonehead Biden, who wants more of the same, isn't going to do it, folks. She will be the populist to the lefties, just as Trump was to the righties. But the sociopathic elite will still demonize her, of course. So the end of the article, they gave Democrats advice to take with them, you know, since the rich are so smart, we got to listen to them. It says, for his part, Jones appears to prefer South Bend, Indiana Mayor Pete the Booty Judge in 2020 presidential race.
I love Pete. I love Mayor Pete because I think he would be the best administrator to run this country. He's my man.
Though Jones added, At the time, he's not politically active, but the hedge fund manager has given to both Republicans and Democrats in the past, including the last 12 months. Yeah, you're not that politically active anymore. Because you win no matter who gets elected, your class owns our government, and unless there is a revolution, nothing will systemically change. So part of the propaganda here is having smug, disgusting, mentally ill billionaires that hoard money say that we don't want Warren to win, and that makes some Democrats want to vote for her as if she is almost as radical as Bernie, which is untrue. In reality, the plutocrats are fine with Elizabeth Warren because she is a trusted and vetted servant of the plutocrats, and nothing would change but perhaps tiny incremental measures to alleviate some public outrage over health care and a tiny tax increase to the super rich to make it seem like they're doing something. They are, of course, willing to accept that, but will fight and be dramatic about it, of course. Trump, or any Republican, is just great for plutocrats because they love the whole plutonomy system and admit it because it's their manufactured ideology that they just love. But Trump is so bad at playing president, they probably worry about him shooting his mouth off or doing something really dumb or inciting protests. So this is a seemingly hit piece on Warren, but it's actually an endorsement as well. Now keep this in mind. The next president will preside over the greatest depression ever. How fun, huh? And if it's a Democrat, they'll blame it all on socialist ideas that wreck the economy. And then we'll have another neo-fascist in high office again. Yeah, sheepies, go ahead and vote for the fake socialist capitalist Democrat. But the markets will suffer, you know, because the top 1% who owns 83% of all stocks, you don't want to upset them. Or maybe they won't trickle down their golden liquid upon you anymore. So don't mess with their much-deserved money that they take out of society and stash away as digits on a computer that represent how awesome and important they are, you know, for being obscenely and insanely rich. Well, it goes on. Billionaire investor Paul Tudor Jones believes the S&P 500 would plunge 25% if Senator Elizabeth Warren clinches a 2020 election, but sees another 15% upside for the market if President Donald Trump wins re-election.
Her policies would, assuming they were implemented, probably give you something like that.
As an investor, you have to have a view on the election because the outcomes are so extreme. I've never seen this kind of polarity in elections as we have now.
Oh, gosh. By the way, policies that plutocrats don't like don't get implemented. That's why they bought the Senate and why we need a revolution and a total turnover in 2020 to common, rational people with a heart serving us.
Jones also critiqued those who claim a president has little impact on the direction of the stock market.
It does make a difference. Ronald Reagan, when he became president, was a huge difference in the stock market. And I would say the next president is also going to have a huge impact on the economy and the stock market, particularly asset pricing. This one is going to be more meaningful than anyone certainly in my lifetime.
Oh, my God. They all say every election they say it's the most important one, you know, to make it seem like our vote matters.
Well, it doesn't.
Even if Tulsi Gabbard won, which we all know they would never allow, nothing she proposed would pass in the Senate, and she would be smeared and demonized until her lame duck time was up or she was assassinated. And remember, we have a voting system that is so purposely ignorant that it can be rigged when need be. Also, if this billionaire rat thinks the present market has anything in common with the market of the Reagan era, he's basically brain dead. Nothing is real anymore. They didn't have quantitative easing in the 80s, you dimwitted con man fool. one of Warren's central campaign promises, and a policy pariah on Wall Street, is to impose a 2% tax on households with a net worth of over $50 million, and a 3% tax on household net worth over $1 billion. She later upped that rate to 6% after elaborating on her Medicare for All proposal. Opponents like Cooperman claim that the wealth tax would unduly punish those who made their fortunes from hard work and innovation. Oh, all those business meetings where you figure out how to scam people more is such hard work, huh? Proponents claim, however, that economic disparity in the U.S. remains a problematic and pernicious issue, and that more progressive ideas are needed to be done to remedy wide disparities in household wealth. Yeah, like a 3% tax on billionaires. It would help so much because it's so extreme. Everything will be equal then. Believe me, they will pay 6% more if it avoids popular uprising and appeases the sheepies for a little bit longer. You think these psychopaths would even notice 6% less in their portfolios? How could they? We're talking about billionaires. Anyways, this propaganda of don't tax the rich, they deserve it all, and having them hoard so much dough is good for the economy. And they do so much charity, you know. You can't find a homeless guy or a hungry person anywhere thanks to their charitable hearts. Well, Republicans don't care how much money is hoarded by billionaires. They think no one should pay tax, and maybe we should return to the wild, wild west days, and everyone could end disputes with a shootout. Hee-haw! Well, these turd-brain idiots don't matter. They are a minority of fools and an obstacle to social progress, but the Democrat Party is the biggest obstacle to change and progress because they are the only other option the plutocrats allow. Pick a side, sheepies. Deceptive Democrats or regressive Republicans. And both are just as subservient to the plutocrats, so it doesn't really matter, but don't talk about that. They are both the defenders of the status quo, plutonomy, but the Democrats have softer and more deceptive rhetoric. Check this out from Business Insider. Hillary Clinton called the wealth taxes proposed by Senators Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren
unworkable
and said they would be
incredibly disruptive
if enforced. Yeah. Incredibly disruptive, huh, Miss Sociopathic Rat? Overtaking 3% of their obscene wealth, huh? The truth is, it would only be mildly disruptive to the good mood of the spoiled, greedy class of rotten and satanic crybabies. Warren has proposed an ultra-millionaire tax of 2% on American households' net worth between $50 million and $1 billion, and of 3% on household net worths above $1 billion. Sanders supports a similar version that begins with a 1% tax on wealth over $32 million. Oh, come on, Bernie. That's asking too much. They need all that. They got to hoard more money to feel better about their soulless selves. Hillary Clinton said,
I just don't understand how that could work. And I don't see other examples anywhere else in the world where it actually worked over a long period of time.
Clinton said at the New York Times Dell Book Conference on Wednesday. Clinton argued that it would be difficult to fairly evaluate Americans' net worth and would force many people to sell their assets to pay the taxes, since the super rich often hoard their value in assets like stocks. Oh, my God. If they had to sell some stocks, that would be so disruptive. And the money is better left in their portfolios rather than, you know, using it for social issues like healthcare. Can you imagine having $50 million to your name and complaining about paying an extra 1% tax increase? Most members of Congress are very rich. Some are multimillionaires and own investment stock in, are employed by, and receive retirement pensions from federal contractors to whom they direct billions of taxpayer dollars. Our democratically elected leaders are part of the greedy class and represent the rich, and they get reelected 97% of the time. Partly because no one good ever runs against them. You know, because you have to be rich to begin with to run for a Senate seat. So no one good can run. No one honest. No one of the middle class can run. And this country is an insane asylum that does everything ass backwards, and no one even seems to care. Elections are used for the illusion of democracy, mass distraction, and gives false hope for change to sheepies. That's why campaigns are never ending now. Do you notice that? Campaigns never end, even right after the election, another one begins. Now, it is inevitable that this blatant level of plutocrat rule and inequality is going to be noticed by increasingly more sheepies, no matter how dumb they are. And I am presently surprised that I'm hearing previously useless people and even mainstream propaganda media outlets starting to say things I've been saying for decades. You know, just with less style and conviction and confidence, like I give. And of course, they act as if there is no solutions but the idiotic, incremental bullcrap proposals that must be debated for a few more years. Most people know things are wrong, and we've reached peak inequality. So I found this in the CBS propaganda news. The richest 400 families in the U.S. now pay a lower overall tax rate than the middle class. The first time that's happened in 100 years. Now remember, these sick rats have more wealth than over half of the population of the world. Then it said, the U.S. now looks like the tax system of a plutocracy. Wow. But, you know, yeah, it only looks like that, right, CBS? I mean, it's not really that bad yet, right? Ugh. In 1970, the richest Americans paid, all taxes included, more than 50% of their income in taxes, twice as much as working class individuals. In 2018, following the Trump tax reform, and for the first time in the last 100 years, billionaires have paid less than steel workers, school teachers, and retirees. Yeah, well, that's because they tax labor more than capital gains. So it's okay, right, Republicans? Because they worked so hard at investing. And, you know, Democrats would rather talk about some goofball Trump talked to in Ukraine instead of all the real horrific things he's done, like that tax cut plan.
No, we're going to try to impeach him because he wanted a quid pro quo on Biden. Ooh, that matters so much to our lives, doesn't it, assholes?
Ooh, sorry. Oh, God, I'm just so upset when I think about how our government operates and seeing these idiots in their suits all acting like they're earning their money doing something for the people holding these freaking impeachment hearings. It's insane. I'm sorry. I'm going to calm down a little bit. And I'm sorry, I'm very congested, so I hope you can understand me, all right? It's just insane, all the horrible things this president has done, from war on nature, denying climate change, deregulating environmental regulations, you know, Clean Water Act, just poison everything everywhere. But we're going to focus on this stupid-ass phone conversation of a country that we overthrew the leadership to have these idiots in there. We love right-wing fascists, don't we? All right, I'm sorry. Let me get back to my point. Oh, I got a headache today, too. I am not feeling good, my friends. Well, you know, that makes sense, right? People who work hard to earn money to survive should pay more tax than rich pricks who get millions for doing nothing and sucking money away from society. Gotcha. I'm sure every American thinks that's fair, right? At the end, they say, the rich are getting richer. That allows them to shape public policies to extract further tax breaks and other benefits
boosting their wealth and political clout.
Really? So this is a new phenomenon, huh?
So you don't have to admit they already have total control over government policy in whole, and we have reached peak plutocracy, and you dumbass propagandists assisted this dreadful outcome over decades of reporting their propaganda as truth. The only reason things of half-truth and lies of omission like this or on climate change is reported now is because it can't be hidden anymore and a new propaganda campaign is needed. Now, the dummycrat politicians must at least pretend to challenge the filthy rich to appeal to their sheep herd. Well, you know, not the neoliberal rats like Biden and Buttigieg. I don't know how the status quo can appeal to any non-wealthy sheepy, but Warren and Bernie have to offer incremental change, so they say stuff like a 3% tax hike on the filthy rich will solve everything. Sanders goes farther and should be the clear front runner because he's saying stuff like this. The $3.8 billion in annual U.S. military aid to Israel should be leveraged to end the horrific treatment of Palestinians. Okay, well, that's a good notion. But how about fixing everything at once like I propose, like my idea to a fair trade and assistance accord? In it is a stipulation that if you are barbaric, you get nothing from us, and we won't do business with you. If you are oppressive and aggressive to your own people or your neighbors, like Israel is to Palestine, and Indonesia is to West Papua and East Timor back in the 70s, and as the Saudi head choppers are to Yemen, if I was president, I would announce we won't deal with cruel governments until they adopt our human rights policy in the accord. So if you still have public executions, you're out. The Saudis average like 150 a year, you know, just to scare the crap out of their Arab sheepies, to keep them in obedience to the plutocrat royalty. If we ended plutocracy decades ago, America could have led the way to world peace and prosperity and shared research. We could have been the spreaders of humanity instead of debt and servitude to the established global plutocracy, which is a cancer on the planet. But if we took back our government now and announced this worldwide fair trade and assistance accord that went into effect as soon as it is signed or refused, the governments committing human rights violations would have to agree or the people would revolt. Anyways, dummycrat propaganda is pretend opposition to massive inequality with tiny incremental suggestions that go nowhere. On the other side of the insanity is the regressive Republican campaign. And all they got is scare tactics. That's it. And that's all they ever had. That's all Trumpy Dumpty does is campaign 24/7. Spreading fear. The president is so lacking of intellectual capacity and so detectably phony and conniving and greedy and foolish that he perfectly exemplifies American plutocracy. You know what? You know how he always says no one is better than him at, well, just about everything? Well, maybe he is the best man for the job because there is one thing he is truly great at. The only thing Trump really is the best at, and nobody does it better? You know what that is? He puts the plut in plutocrat. Ow!
Like a coup d'etat. great, tremendous, amazing, and all that. 'Cause the man in the tinfoil hat is tweeting like a teenage girl. He puts the Pluto in Plutocrat, but it's gonna be because the man in the tinfoil hat is sitting on the throne tonight. It kind of feels like a coup d'etat, but it's gonna be usual. 'Cause the man and all that, 'cause the man in the tinfoil hat is tweeting like a teenage girl. He puts the Pluto in Pluto's hat. The country gonna be usual. 'Cause the man in the tinfoil hat is sitting on the throne.
That was Tinfoil Hat off Todd Rundgren's latest album, White Knight. Now, that song was done with the great Donald Fagen from Steely Dan. Good song and great work, guys. You're really moving up in the world now, because both artists have been honored to have been featured on the Plutocracy Report more than once. So congratulations. I'm sure it was a thrill of a lifetime. Only artists like Roger Waters and Mick Wop Music have had the honor until now. Oh, and Wilco, I think, of being on the Plutocracy Report more than once. All right, well, I hope you enjoyed that song. Now let's move on. Well, at this point in time, we are seeing protests and uprisings around the world. I talked a little bit about it last show. It's inspiring me, but we must get our anti-plutocracy movement going right here. The world is waiting for us to stand up and lead the way in America. We have reached a level of peak inequality and irrational governance. This is a pivotal point in human history, and with glimmers of resistance around the world, we're still seeing the bad side of humanity winning, and we the people in America have yet to join the battle. The only thing I saw in the Plutocrat media about protests was that a cop shot a Hong Kong protester because, you know, that's the only protest they support. Which doesn't make it illegitimate to all you idiots who don't support the Hong Kong protesters just because Marco Rubio supports them. Grow the hell up. These people want change. You think just because idiots here support them, it's illegitimate? Nah, these people have it hard there. Support them. The media won't say a word about Palestinian protesters who've been shot and killed and brutalized on a never-ending basis, but they let us know about one person getting shot in Hong Kong, huh? Also, it's very troubling to hear the fascist, plutocrat-loving rats got in via military coup in Bolivia. And this looks really disgusting to me. Bolivia's socialist president, Evo Morales, was forced to resign Sunday under threat from the nation's military, police forces, and violent right-wing protesters who have burned and ransacked the homes of members of Morales' party. They assaulted supporters of the president and kidnapped a Bolivian mayor. They dragged this poor lady barefoot through the streets. They cut her hair, covered her in red paint, and forced her to sign a resignation letter. It made me very sad, and, you know, I got choked up a bit watching the video. And there she was, splattered with red paint, their hair chopped off, humiliated at the dirty hands of the scoundrels, and she looked so composed and cool as can be, and said, "I am not afraid to tell the truth. I am in a free country, and I'm not going to shut up. If they want to kill me, they kill me. As I've said before, for this process of change, I will give my life." Ah, oh, what a woman. Can we fight for people like her and the others with good morals? I mean, they kill or imprison the heroes, and it's time we stand up for justice around the world. You know, let's start with Assange before he dies in prison. But this was a military coup. Excuse me. This was a military coup in Bolivia. And of course, our wretched plutocrats orchestrated it all. This is what former Brazilian president Lula da Silva said, who was freed from prison last Friday after spending more than a year behind bars on politically motivated charges, you know, which allowed for Bastardo Bolsonaro to win. "There was a coup in Bolivia, and Comrade Evo Morales was forced to resign," Lula tweeted. "It is unfortunate that Latin America has an economic elite that does not know how to live with democracy and the social inclusion of the poorest." Now, the fascist protesters say the vote there in Bolivia was voter fraud. And I heard someone that we know say that the guy wanted a fourth term and he just wouldn't go away. Yeah. Who else was like that, Mr. Someone We Know? Oh, FDR did it, remember? Because the people liked the way he was trying to help them, and the alternative was bad. And, of course, the talk of voter fraud is pure bullcrap, because the people can't buy elections. Only the plutocrats can afford to rig elections, and are the only ones who need to do it, because their ideology is detrimental to the majority of people. So they're the ones who have to cheat to win in less brainwashed countries than America, you know, the land of delusion. I don't know that much about Evo and what forces he had to fight within his country to achieve any social progress. But I do know he lifted 1/5 out of poverty and the economy was doing better for the people. So, you know, it's like Venezuela. The socialist leadership helps the poor a little, but life still sucks for many. And systemic change is never achieved because money is still all that matters in globalization and local socioeconomics. That's why the entire economic system must change and the dichotomy of communism or capitalism must end to achieve rational self-governance and new planning. Only when we end the system can we manage and govern rationally and humanely. The economic elite hates socialism and wants every country worth anything to be in their nexus of exploitation. The plutocrats want Bolivia. You know, they want it to be another vassal state for America now more than ever. And partly because Bolivia has some of the world's largest reserves of lithium, which is a key component in batteries that power electric cars. This I found from last February, so almost a year ago. Bolivia has chosen a Chinese consortium to be its strategic partner on a new 2.3 billion lithium projects, giving China a potential foothold in the country's huge untapped reserves of the prized electric battery metal. Why China? Because there's a guaranteed market in China for battery production, Brazilian President Evo Morales said. Lithium is the key ingredient for batteries fueling the world's electric car and smartphone revolution. Oh, revolution, huh? That's what it is. Freaking morons. Market analysts speculate that by mid-2020s, lithium supply will be straining to keep up with demand from auto and mobile device manufacturers. It's being called
the gold of the 21st century.
Bolivia's largely untapped saladi unida saladi yoni salt flats located high in the Andes are estimated to contain between 25 and 45% of the planet's known reserves. The government of Evo Morales had been working to create a publicly owned lithium industry to help diversify his country's economy and raise more people out of poverty. Oh, you don't want to do that, Evo. That's not what the plutocrats want. That is the enemy of the plutocrats. No public interests. Only private interests will be tolerated around the world. Overthrowing governments is just a business venture to plutocrats. I posted this a week before last Sunday's coup from Telesur. The Radio Education Network of Bolivia leaked 16 audios involving opposition leaders who are calling for a coup d'etat against the government of President Evo Morales, a political action which would have been coordinated from the U.S. Embassy in the Ardeen County. Among these mentioned in the audios are the U.S. Senators Marco Rubio,
Bob Menendez,
and Ted Cruz,
who would have maintained contact with the Bolivian opposition in order to achieve a possible regime change in the South American country. So I guess Rat Boy Rubio, he must be on the plutocrats' socialist overthrow team. What a disgrace, huh? Well, I'm going to keep my eyes on this, my friends, and I will learn more about Evo and report on it. I mean, the people in Bolivia and all over the world are going to stand up against plutocrat plunder, and so must we, right here in America. But now, the Plutocracy Report is proud to present
the triumphant return of the award-winning radio segment,
Hell Going On Out There.
Oh boy, it's been a while for this, my friends.
So let's do this, baby. Here we go.
First up,
Jeff Bezos says space travel is essential because we are in the process of destroying this planet.
Oh, yes, you are indeed, you goofy-eyed prick with ears. Jeff Bezos says humans need space travel because they are
destroying the planet.
He doesn't mean that humanity will have to evacuate a dying Earth, however, but rather that we could outsource our most destructive behaviors to space. You know, because we can't change our destructive behavior. That would cost billions in loss of profits to scumbags. And rockets is all that really matters to humanity.
Right, Jeff?
Speaking with the CBS News anchor, Nora O'Donnell,
Bezos,
whose space exploration company, Blue Origin, hopes to put people back on the moon as soon as 2024, courtesy of its Blue Moon lunar lander, seemed pessimistic about the effect humans were having on Earth.
Oh, God.
We humans have to go to space if we're going to continue to have a thriving society,
he said.
We have become big as a population, as a species, and this planet is relatively small.
Jesus.
We see it in things like climate change and pollution and heavy industry. We are in the process of destroying this planet.
Yet despite that, he emphasizes that Earth was the best place for us. Oh, God, what a genius, huh?
We have sent robotic probes to every planet in the solar system. This is a good one, he said.
Oh, my God, this guy is so infantile and stupid. Rather than advocate resettlement, Bezos said,
humankind could preserve Earth using the resources of space.
Oh, God. So a complete moron is allowed to amass well over $100 billion and has no intention to use it to help humanity, and we can't even agree on taxing him 3% more? Are we crazy? The hell going on out there?
I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the world. I'm afraid I can't help it. I'm afraid I can't.
Next, we have this. One in four Americans apparently unaware the Earth orbits the sun.
I'm afraid I can't help it.
Does the Earth go around the Sun, or does the Sun go around the Earth?
When asked that question, 1 in 4 Americans surveyed answered incorrectly. Yes, 1 in 4. In other words, 1/4 of Americans do not understand one of the most fundamental principles of basic science. So that's where we are as this so-called advanced society right now. The survey conducted by National Science Foundation included more than 2,200 participants in the U.S. Were they from Alabama or maybe West Virginia? Because then I wouldn't be all that too surprised. It featured a 9-question quiz about physical and biological science, and the average score was 6.5. And the fact that only 74% of the participants knew that the Earth revolved around the Sun is perhaps less alarming than the fact that only 48% knew that humans evolved from earlier species of animals. Here's the thing, though. Americans actually fared better than Europeans who took similar quizzes. At least when it comes to the Sun and Earth question, only 66% of European Union sheepies answered that one correctly.
Really? I thought European sheepies were smarter than Americans.
Are you kidding me? Some of them can't even communicate and enunciate anymore. They sound like dummies with their stupid, heavy accents. Yeah, it's hard to imagine they can be dumber than American sheepies, you know, where 30% of the people believe the Bible is the literal word of God. You know, in that gay people can become straight if they just pray away the gay. Clearly, American plutocrat culture has intentionally dumbed down the nation. Even billionaires like Bezos are blithering idiots. But don't look to Europe for intelligent people, because the truth is, people, we are dumb all over. The hell going on out there?
I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the world.
This is freaking hilarious here. Facebook is the biggest threat to U.S. democracy, Cambridge Analytica whistleblower says. Sounds like a smart person here, huh? Facebook's approach to political advertising shows why it presents a serious risk to American democracy. Cambridge Analytica whistleblower Brittany Kaiser told CNBC on Tuesday,
Facebook is actually the biggest threat to our democracy. It's not just foreign actors,
Kaiser said on closing bell.
I say that specifically because it was only 2 weeks ago that Mark Zuckerberg decided that Facebook is not going to censor politicians that are spreading disinformation, weaponizing racial hatred, and even using voter suppression tactics.
Really, Brittany? They suppress votes through Facebook, huh? This ditz was the director at Cambridge Analytica, a disgusting and deceptive company.
But now she's a hero of democracy, right, CNBC?
Earlier this month, Facebook said it would not prevent President
Donald Trump's
re-election campaign from running an ad with false claims about former Vice President
Joe Biden
and his son.
Oh, no! How is Bonehead Biden going to win now?
In September, as the 2020 U.S. presidential election approaches, Facebook said it will not fact-check or remove content posted by politicians, even if it is in violation of the company's rules.
Oh my God, Brittany! How can we save our democracy if we don't have massive censorship?
You know, because the people can't decide things for themselves and do research to determine what's true and false. But be positive, Brittany, because mass censorship is growing.
And don't you just love it, girl?
Wasn't it great when Facebook labeled Palestinian journalism hate speech and shuts down their pages? Isn't that great, Brittany? I'm telling you, Facebook is important, and we need it to be publicly owned and uncensored, even if stupid comic book conspiracy Alex Jones crap is out there, because we can determine if it's true ourselves. We're not idiots. Well, we don't have to be idiots. Fascist book is the only way to get random alternative news out of the mainstream propaganda, and the plutocrat puppets are working to censor it. All we are is consumers and attractors of advertising dollars to Zuckerberg. That factor is all that stands against total censorship. So we live in a country where idiot sheepies are given a platform to preach about how we need more censorship to protect our democracy? Meaning that there are still sheepies out there that actually still believe this plutocracy is a democracy? What the hell going on out here?
I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the world. I'm afraid of cats.
Okay, well, that was enraging, but also cathartic for me. Collective ignorance is our biggest obstacle to social progress. So let's call out the dummies. Don't respect their ignorant opinions. It doesn't matter if they wear a stupid suit with a colorful noose tie around their neck. Let them have it and give them a verbal smackdown. Maybe they'll finally wake up. Look at how outdated our fashion for men still is. The business suit and tie is a ridiculous looking getup and not very comfortable as well. I would never wear one. In an intelligent society, comfort is what would matter most to your attire. I laugh at men in suits. You know, as much as I laugh at the baggy pants, ass crack showing goofballs out there. All right, enough of my ramblings. I ran out of time. Well, let's end the show with some good news. In solidarity with Palestine, Norway's capital just banned Israel products. All right, well, that's a step in the right direction, at least. And now for some domestic good news. Well, I can't think of any right now. I'll tell you what, my friends, if anyone finds any good news of resistance or progressive change going on in America, shoot me an email at theplutocracyreport@gmail.com, and I'll talk about it. Thanks for joining me. Speak out against the plutocrats. Absorb and radiate love. And until next time, my friends, this was the Plutocracy Report, and I'm Vince Marcanti. Till next time, bye-bye.